Hello, this is Robin de Graaf and welcome to another video on the basics of NMR, in which I will focus on signal excitation and nuclear induction. Let's first recap some of the information on nuclear magnetization that was discussed in an earlier video. You can find it on YouTube, simply search for nuclear magnetization. Suppose that we have a subject in a strong external magnetic field, like an MRI scanner. If you now look at a small volume in the brain of this subject, it will contain billions and billions of nuclear spins. The far majority of these nuclear spins are in a random orientation. And therefore 99.9% of these spins, when you add the magnetic moments together, they'll end up, with no signal at all. They cancel each other perfectly. However, because the external magnetic field is present, a small amount of nuclear spins are biased towards the parallel or low energy state. If you now add the magnetic moments of these spins together, you'll end up with a net magnetization, the so-called thermal equilibrium magnetization, M0, along the z-axis, parallel to the main magnetic field. Now, it is this M0 that is the NMR signal. However, it is almost never observed this way because there are other sources of magnetization that are many orders of magnitude larger than the nuclear magnetization. Therefore, in NMR, we do a trick in which we rotate M0 towards the XY plane, the transverse plane, at which point it starts to rotate at a very unique and specific Larmor frequency that is very easy to observe and very easy to distinguish from other sources of magnetization. Now, the magnetization can be rotated towards the transverse plane by a second magnetic field, B1, that is perpendicular to the magnetization. The magnetization experiences a torque and starts to rotate away from the z-axis. As soon as the magnetization is away from the z-axis, it starts to rotate at the Larmor frequency, because it is built up of the sum of the individual nuclear spins, and they're all rotating at the Larmor frequency. Now, suppose that we're at a magnetic field of 3 Tesla, corresponding to 128 megahertz for a proton nuclear spins. Therefore, in 3.9 nanoseconds, the entire sphere has rotated by 180 degrees. If the magnetization rotated away from the z-axis during the first few nanoseconds, after the sphere has been rotated by 180 degrees, the magnetization now rotates towards the z-axis. In other words, if we use a static magnetic field B1, we don't really achieve anything because the B1 field is not in resonance with the spin Larmor frequency. The magnetization will simply wobble back and forth, but will never get a coherent rotation. In order to get a coherent rotation, the B1 magnetic field needs to have a constant phase relationship with the magnetization M0. And that can be achieved by rotating the B1 field at the same Larmor frequency as the nuclear spins. When the B1 field is rotating at the same frequency, it has a constant angle relative to M0, and therefore it has a constant torque towards rotation towards the XY plane. We can now adjust this angle, alpha, which is referred to as the flip angle or nutation angle, to be, for example, exactly 90 degrees. Then it is referred to as an excitation. We can also make alpha 180 degrees, and then it rotates all the way to the minus z-axis, and then the magnetization is said to be inverted. I would like to point out that you don't excite just the M0 vector. The entire spin orientation sphere has been excited. So that includes the 99.9% of the randomly oriented spins. Those are being rotated. But after the rotation, you still have no signal. But also the spins that were initially biased to along the z-axis, parallel to the main magnetic field, they are also rotated. And the spins are now biased along the y-axis, making it that M0 has been rotated from z to y. Now, this flip angle alpha is given by this equation. And you can see that you can adjust the rotation angle by either changing the amplitude of the secondary magnetic field or its duration. Another thing I would like to point out is that I've been now saying that B1 is a rotating magnetic field, which is indeed correct. However, it rotates at the Larmor frequency, and the Larmor frequency for most MRI systems is in the radio frequency or RF range. Furthermore, the B1 field is turned on for a short duration T and then turned off again. In other words, it's being applied as a pulse. So the rotating magnetic field B1 is very often referred to as a radio frequency or RF pulse. This will be discussed in great detail in a future video. So we have excited our magnetization in the transverse plane, and our net magnetization M0 is along the y-axis. Of course, it's not going to stay there forever. We already know from the previous video that T1 relaxation leads to the buildup of magnetization along the z-axis. The disappearance of the magnetization from the transverse plane is governed by something called T2 relaxation. The underlying mechanisms are the same, in which molecular tumbling and the fluctuations in magnetic field lead to a loss of phase coherence. So after we wait, let's say 100 milliseconds, you can see that the spins have lost a little bit of phase coherence, and if you add them all together, the total net magnetization in red is now reduced. However, the level of phase coherence in NMR is pretty amazing. If we look at protons at 7 tesla, then during these 100 milliseconds, the spins have processed 30 million times, and they've only lost a little bit of phase coherence. This will be similar to a regular clock running for 60 years straight and only being off by less than a minute, for example. Now, of course, if you wait long enough, let's say 1000 milliseconds, then the phase coherence gets less and less, and at some point you have lost all your net magnetization. And of course, T1 relaxation has built up that magnetization along the z-axis. Now, this process in which the magnetization disappears from the transverse plane is T2 relaxation. It is a microscopic random process, and therefore it is irreversible. It is an irreversible loss of phase coherence. Now, under many experimental conditions, signal disappears much faster from the transverse plane than by T2 relaxation alone. And that is because there are other processes, macroscopic processes, that lead to additional loss of phase coherence. And that collection of additional processes is referred to as T2 star relaxation. They're typically based on macroscopic effects, and they can be reversed. This will be the subject of a future video. Let's look at an example. If we look at the human brain, and we look at this volume over here, then you can see that if you look at the magnetic field in that volume, ideally it is the same everywhere. Let's say 3 tesla. However, because you have a boundary between water in the brain and air in the nasal cavity over there, you're going to get a disturbance of the main magnetic field. And you can see that spins on the bottom have a slightly higher magnetic field than spins on the top. That means that spins on the bottom have a slightly higher Larmor frequency than spins on the top. And after they have been excited, they rotate in the transverse plane over a larger angle. So after some time, spins on the bottom have acquired more phase than spins on the top. When we get signal from the entire volume, we're going to get phase cancellation. In other words, we're going to get loss of phase coherence. Now, T2 and T2 star relaxation are exponential processes given by an equation something like this, in which the decay constant is equal to T2 or T2 star. It should also be pointed out that T2 star is always smaller than T2, and it is the purpose of magnetic field shimming to make T2 star as close to T2 as possible by reducing inhomogeneity in the magnetic field. That will be the subject of an entirely different video as well. So finally, we are now at the point where we can start to talk about nuclear induction. We have excited our magnetization into the transverse plane. We know that it starts to rotate at the Larmor frequency, and it decreases over time because of T2 star relaxation. We have a varying magnetic field. If we now place a loop in the transverse plane, then a time varying magnetic field induces a voltage in that loop via electromagnetic induction. that signal can be amplified and received in the MR spectrometer, and that represents our detected NMR signal. It is referred to as the free induction decay, or FID. If we observe it along the x-axis, it looks like this. You can also observe it along the y-axis, then it looks like this. And ideally, you observe it along both axes at the same time. When we do that, then typically the signal is combined into a complex valued signal, in which the real component corresponds to, for example, the x, and the imaginary component corresponds to the y component. You can see all the important parameters are in this FID signal in a time domain. M0, which is our thermal equilibrium magnetization, corresponds to the first point amplitude. The decay of the signal over time is governed by T2 star relaxation, and the distance between one maximum here and a maximum there is 1 divided by the Larmor frequency. Now, if we only have a single frequency in our FID signal, it is very easy to extract all these parameters. However, we will see later that NMR can have multiple frequencies in an FID, and then it will be very difficult to visually separate the signals. Fortunately, there is a very easy tool, which is called the Fourier transformation, that can convert the time domain signal into a frequency domain spectrum. And if you have multiple resonances, multiple signals, you can separate those signals based on their frequency in the spectrum. And we'll talk about that in a future video as well. The parameters are all present in the spectrum as well, but they look a little bit different. So for example, M0, which is the first point here, now corresponds to the area under the signal in the spectrum. The T2 decay now is given by 1 over the line width, for example. Now, if NMR was only concerned with a single frequency for, let's say, protons, and a single frequency for carbon-13, it would not be a very interesting technique. Fortunately, there is an additional effect to NMR that makes it a very powerful analytical technique, and that effect has to do with electronic shielding. Let's say that we have a nuclear spin in an external magnetic field B0. The magnetic field experienced by the nucleus is identical, and therefore you're going to get a certain resonance line at a certain frequency. However, having a single nucleus is not realistic. At a very minimum, there will be electrons around that nucleus, and those electrons generate their own magnetic field that opposes the external magnetic field B0. In other words, the magnetic field experienced by the nucleus is the sum of B0 and the electronic magnetic field, and therefore the magnetic field at the nucleus is reduced compared to B0. Therefore, the resonance frequency, the Larmor frequency, has been reduced as well. So you can see when the electronic shielding increases, the magnetic field at the nucleus decreases, and therefore the Larmor frequency also decreases. Now, a single nucleus with a few electrons is typically not realistic either. It's going to be part of a larger molecule. And for example, here you have a hydrogen atom combined with a, for instance, a carbon atom. The carbon might be more electronegative, therefore it pulls a little bit of the electron density away from the protons, making the electronic shielding field a little bit less strong, and therefore increasing the field at the nucleus. And therefore the resonance frequency goes to a higher value. And so you can see here that depending on the exact electronic structure of a nucleus, in other words, the chemical environment, you're going to get a different resonance frequency for a different compound, or even for a different group within, like a given chemical compound. You can also see that the Larmor frequency equation that was introduced in an earlier video, where the Larmor frequency is directly proportional to B0, should really be interpreted as the Larmor frequency is proportional to the field at the nucleus. So it includes a shielding effect. So let's see if we understand, like the shielding in a typical molecule that we observe in vivo, lactic acid, which is a metal group, the 3 green protons, a single blue proton here, close to several other oxygens. Now, oxygen is a very electronegative atom, meaning that it likes to draw electron density towards itself. And therefore, that means that the electronic shielding on this proton is not very good, making it that it has a high frequency. These three protons are much further away from the oxygens, therefore the electronic shielding is better, therefore the magnetic field at the nucleus is lower, and therefore the Larmor frequency is lower. And therefore, lactic acid, these four protons give rise to two resonances, one at a high frequency and one at a low frequency. The intensity corresponds to 1 and 3, because this one originates from one proton, this originates from three protons. Now, this is the spectrum that we get at 3 Tesla. At 7 Tesla, you would get a similar spectrum, but the numbers will be completely different. This is not very convenient. Right? If you want to compare spectra between different magnets or different laboratories, you're having always to convert very large numbers. To deal with that, we have a so-called referencing method, where we use a standard a compound, in this case DSS, in which the protons in these three metal groups are defined to resonate at 0 ppm. Using this equation, you can convert these numbers to numbers as a chemical shift in ppm. And on this axis, this resonance from lactate is always at 1.3 ppm, and this resonance is always at 4.1 ppm. Doesn't matter if you're 3 Tesla, 7 Tesla, or 1 Tesla. And so that's a very convenient field-independent scale. So to wrap up, in NMR, we play a little bit of a trick in that we rotate the nuclear magnetization to the transverse plane, at which point it will start to rotate at a very specific and unique Larmor frequency. The rotation is achieved with a secondary magnetic field called B1, but it's also referred to as an radio frequency or RF pulse that is rotating at the same Larmor frequency. The rotating magnetization that is in the transverse plane generates a voltage in a nearby receiver coil via electromagnetic induction, and that is our detected NMR signal. Electronic shielding leads to a reduction of the magnetic field at the nucleus, and therefore to a reduction of the Larmor frequency. As different chemical groups in a molecule have different electronic shieldings, they will give different resonances, and that gives NMR the great analytical power. The chemical shift scale is just a convenient field-independent scale. For those of you who are interested, there are a few exercises that you can do. Finally, if you want to contact me, this is how I look like. So if you see me at meetings, please come over and talk to me. You can also contact me by email. You can visit the website, which is under construction at the moment. And you can read most of the things I've been talking about in the third edition of In Vivo NMR Spectroscopy. I hope that you've enjoyed this video, and I hope that you will visit again to see some other videos in the future. Thank you.